All right, class, sit down, be quiet, and get out your pencils. Welcome back to the resurrection of Lemme School Ya, where we try to go through tips and tricks and all that good stuff for you to make your creative product with a little more skill. So let's not dilly-dally. Today's subject is armature versus story. Have you ever sat down with a group of friends and talked about some kind of story, and one person goes, "The story was about how we as a species need to move forward." And another one goes, "I thought it was about personal growth." And a third one goes, "The hell are you talking about? It was obviously about how humans destroy themselves with the tools they develop to hurt others." And you're just sitting there going, "I don't know, I just thought Gurren Lagann was about cool fighting robots." Why is this? You all watched the same thing, yet you perceived it differently. And really, when you're just watching it, it is just a bunch of cool robots blowing each other up. So, how can all your friends come to all these different conclusions? That's because one thing is the story, the other is the armature. So what is armature? Armature is what you wanna tell with your work. If you don't have anything to tell with your story, why even bother telling the story? Gurren Lagann, which will be one of our prime examples for this class, wanted to tell a lot of things. It wanted to tell that we cannot let ourselves be tied down by our past, that we as a species evolve, and we need to remember the past to not repeat its errors, that we have to mature as a people, and much, much more. But just standing there and yelling those things to people won't get your message across. People will just go, "Oh no, Jimmy's off his meds again." So instead, the writers made the story of robots fighting each other. It's the same as parents making plane noises when spoon feeding their kids to make them eat the things they don't want. In other words, while story A is being told, message B is being conveyed at the same time. The thing about message B, however, is that you have to analyze the story to get into it. Now, some things, such as the movie Antichrist by Lars von Trier, only tries to convey B, and seems to forget A. Here you actually have to analyze the movie as you're watching it to get any rhyme or reason out of it. If not, then you'll be horribly confused. In other words, it may have succeeded in B, but failed in A. Which is why many people, such as myself, won't like it. Well, there's that and Willem Dafoe's penis being drilled, but yeah. It's not entertaining, it's just trying to be artsy. If you've ever heard the term a performance art piece, it's usually used to ridicule something, and that is typically when it has failed in doing A and only focused on doing B. So, what can an armature be? Well, typically, I like to say that it's when you want to ask a question or provide an answer. So, if you want to make a story and just tell a story of two kinds, the armature is raising the question of what racism is and how it can be perceived, as poorly conveyed as that may be. Or you can look at Sunstone that doesn't ask a question, but instead tells you talk about your feelings. But then you got, say, Les Lindas. There's no armature here. It doesn't try to tell you anything or ask you anything. Does that mean it's bad? Well, yeah, but not necessarily for that reason. It depends on what you want to do with your product. This whole formula is only for people who want to tell something with their story. And safe to say, Les Lindas couldn't give any less of a fuck. It's the same thing where if you watch Die Hard, you don't necessarily want to learn anything. You just want to watch Bruce Willis blow people away. Welcome to the party, pal! But then you sit down and watch The Road, and you know it wants to tell you something. So, how do you tell the message? How do you get people to dig into your story to find the armature you're trying to convey? Well, there's things such as symbolism. Symbolism is when you're showing one thing, but it's a representation of something else. If we return to Gurren Lagann, the obvious symbolism is obviously the drills that are time and time again used throughout the show. Gurren Lagann has a very strong message about moving forward, which goes really well with the imagery of drills. Drills are meant to pierce through a position and only functions when moving forward. There's your symbolism. is also a reference to a much older mech anime, but anyway. Now, it's important to remember, just because the drill in this example serves the same function as the message the enemy is trying to convey, that's not the only way of doing symbolism. Anyone who knows Christianity, for example, knows that an apple can be symbolic of temptation and a snake of treachery. But it's not like a snake can lie to you, and it's not like an apple is any more tempting to eat than, I don't know, a bag of chips. Well, maybe if you're a health freak. But we link these messages to these symbols due to what functions they serve in the story and what knowledge we have of them. So you also gotta remember that an elephant, as symbolism in the West, might not be conceived in the same way as it will be in the East. Ravia in Ava's Demon has been confirmed to be a symbolism of anxiety and depression, and if you'll remember, I was able to catch on to that because Ravia served the same function as depression and anxiety, which was making you doubt yourself and asking you to kill yourself. The thing to remember about symbolism, however, is that it's only symbolism when it's not immediately apparent or forced down your throat. And why is that important? The point about the armature is that you have something you want to ask or say, but at the same time, you leave it up to the reader to form their own opinion and thoughts. If your armature is that racism is bad, you don't just go out there and go, "Yo, fuck racism." Instead, you portray racism in a super shitty light, and you leave the reader or viewer to go, "Wow, racism is terrible." Remember, you are only planting the seed of the idea in their head, not the idea itself. The reason for this is because if you let the viewer interpret it themselves, they'll reach a conclusion that's more personal to them. If you tell people your message outright, it'll be considered more of a mouthpiece, and you'll be like Jay Naylor or some other obnoxious cunt. It's the same reason why Slenderman was so scary, because you could understand if he just, you know, ate you or tore you limb from limb. But the fact you don't know what he is or what he does, you subconsciously tailor it to your own worst fear. And your own worst fears are not necessarily what other people fear the most. If your worst fear is, say, drowning, well, Slenderman to you might just take you to a lake and drown you. If you're super into war, chances are the super crazy figure won't try and eat you, because you don't fear that. Same thing, what's important to you is not necessarily what's important to others. Hence why if you can make the readers or viewer interpret it to what's important to them, it hits closer to home with them and influences them more. It's also important to remember that using yourself as a reference when it comes to things that matters to people, it's not a good reference. So when making a story, remember who your audience is and research them. Find out what matters to them and then try and tailor it to them. Alright, you guys still with me? You don't need to take five, grab a cup of coffee. What am I talking about? This is a video, you can just pause it. Anyway, if the message is up to free interpretation, how can you have an armature? If the reader is gonna come to their own conclusion, how can you get your message across? Well, that's the job of your story. The more you can narrow the thing to focus on down through your story, with its themes and what's going on, the more focused the receiver will be on what to interpret and how. If we look at Metal Gear 2, Sons of Liberty, one of the things that entire game is about is identity. But the game is a spy drama where the guy who looks like a girl walks around and sucks at everything. Then he kills his dad who tried to control the world through the use of social engineering. Yep, the game isn't exactly focused around identity. So how can it have that as one of its armatures? Well, first of all, let me remind you, Sons of Liberty is the first video game to ever be considered art. And that's because it dealt with a lot of stuff. So how do we get from the social engineering to identity? Well, first of all, we have to get the ball rolling. We have to get the audience from A to B. Once they're in B, and let me remind you, that's the message you're trying to convey underneath the obvious story, they'll try and find things that helps them come to a conclusion. And when diving into a game with as much depth as Sons of Liberty, you are automatically just gonna tumble down the rabbit hole and stumble across all sorts of armature. And as long as you've done your writing right, the information that's spun underneath the surface will then lead them to the message you're trying to convey. Cause, let's face it, you can't just have mystical shit for the sake of having it. You have to want to tell something, even if it's not immediately apparent. And as long as you keep focused on what you want to tell, then you can bet that the audience will reach the question or conclusion you want them to make. Consider the small nuggets you leave on level B as clues for the reader who's the detective. Now, I want to bring you guys' attention to a piece that I personally feel has failed this entire thing miserably, but it's still loved by a lot of people. Steven Universe. Yes, it's time to kick the baby. Remember what I said, that level B shouldn't be immediately apparent because then it just appears as a soapbox for the creator to yell what's sometimes basically just propaganda? Well, you want a case of that, look at Steven Universe. Now, the message is, if you allow me to be personal here, a good message. Gay parents should absolutely be allowed to raise kids, and gay people can be awesome too. So I think that may be one of the reasons why some people pardon the soapbox thing that Steven Universe does, cause it's an all-around good message. That and some people just like the cartoon, and that's fair. But the show doesn't hide anything at all, or at the very least it does a shitty job at it. This has caused many people to feel not just talked down to, but kinda offended with how preachy it is. And when people get like that, like it or not, they're not gonna care about whatever you're selling them. I mean, you can't hit someone and ask them to check out your mixtape. It just doesn't work like that. So, that's why you have to be sneaky. Infiltrate the seeds into the mind of your readers, and then when they are least expecting it, you've sown a concept within them that they now have to face. Like, remember how many people lost their absolute shit when Ellie in The Last of Us turned out to be gay? You've had an entire game, one of the best games ever made, mind you, to start loving this character, think she's cool, think she's cute, think she's funny, think she's lovable in a ton of different ways.
Huh? Yeah, sure, Joel, go ahead, take my cards. Take all my food, too, while you're at it.
By the looks of it, you could lose some of that food.
Listen to me, you little...
And then, whoops, turned out this character you thought was super cool person is now gay. And nothing has changed. Now, imagine how this must be for someone who doesn't like homosexuality. To some, unfortunately, gay people are less than human, and now here's a character they know and love, and she's suddenly gay. The seed's been sown, they think the character's cool, and all the while she was the thing they hated so much. Well, maybe this means that gay people are just, you know, people like the rest. Ellie didn't have to be specially treated or be better than anyone else for this either. She was just one of the characters. She wasn't, say, a deific stone goddess in screaming bright colors with superpowers that were so much better than other normal straight people. You see the difference? One makes you have your guard up because it's doing a full frontal assault on you, while the other has already infiltrated you and influenced you before you knew what hit you. That's the power of the two levels.
Oh God.
So, let's sum up. When you write a story, it's important to ask yourself why you're making this story. What is it you want to tell or ask? Out from this, ask yourself if this is something everyone will just be susceptible to be asked or told. And from that, decide whether to tell or ask them this outright or lead them towards it through symbolism and a subtle message. Because telling or asking them outright won't have the desired effect. Once you've done this, make sure your story supports the message you're trying to convey. Make them go, this is like in this thing where they talk about that or do this when dealing with some things. It should also be stated, these several layers underneath is not necessary. It's simply a tool. So, here's your homework. Go to the Webcomic Relief Discord and find yourself a partner. Write a small, short story that deals with A while conveying B and share it with your partner. Don't tell your partner what the message is. The reader will then have 3 chances to guess what the message is. Afterwards, share notes on why it worked and why it didn't among the class. And you guessed it, the class is the writing talk segment of the Discord. Have fun! This has been Lemme School Ya, here to help you create your creative works with a little more skill.